As we begin today's meeting, we would like to acknowledge that we are gathering here today on the treaty territory, the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, and before them, the traditional territory, the Haudenosaunee, Huron, and Wendat. We also acknowledge the many First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and other global Indigenous people that now call Brampton their home. We are honored to live, work, and enjoy this land. Before we start today's meeting, I'd ask that we pause for a moment to remember those who have passed or are suffering from the COVID-19 virus, and to also reflect and think of all the various frontline workers, healthcare workers, and first responders who are working so hard to serve, protect, and care for all of us. Please all rise for the singing of our national anthem, to be followed by a moment of personal reflection. Welcome to our regular council meeting of May 13th, 2020. We will begin the meeting with the city clerk calling the roll. Call for attendance at today's meeting.
Members of council, I will call your name for the roll call. Councillor Santos.
Here.
Councillor Visante.
Present.
Councillor Willens.
Here.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Present.
Councillor Bowman.
Here.
Councillor Medeiros.
Here.
Councillor Williams.
Here.
Councillor Fortini.
Here.
Councillor Singh. Councillor Singh. We'll come back to you, Councillor. Councillor Dillon.
Here.
Thank you, Councillor Singh. Mr. Mayor, we'll confirm Councillor Singh. He was on before the meeting started, and you're here, so we have 10 members present for certain.
Okay. Thank you to our city clerk. We are now at item 2, approval of agenda. Does any member wish to add a business item to today's meeting? If so, please use the instant messaging section of the Skype to add your name to the speaker's list. And while I go to the speaker's list, Councillor Michael Pelleschi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to add a discussion item on the CIP program.
Okay. Councillor Santos.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to add an item regarding correspondence and advocacy for economic stimulus spending on active transportation infrastructure.
Councillor Willens, and actually, I forwarded you some correspondence we received from Carmen Spada. When we would deal with that? Okay, can we add that then as a discussion item?
Yeah.
Councillor Willens, was your item about the same?
No, I had something else, but I sent it to Peter earlier. I'm just wondering if it got added.
Which one was it? Oh, on community gardens? Okay, we can add that. We can add a discussion item on community gardens.
That's just correspondence.
Okay, you add the correspondence.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Singh. He's asking, have we started? I don't hear anything. Councillor Singh, why don't you call IT and they will help you make sure you can hear. So Councillor Singh, call IT. Okay. Okay, all those in favor of the agenda as...
Mr. Mayor, sorry to interrupt. I have my name on the board. I wanted to add a discussion.
Okay, I don't see your name on the board, but... Early, okay. Councillor Fratini?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm sorry. I wanted to add two things. Something about swimming pools, a discussion. And the second is about change of use.
Okay.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
Hey, Councillor Dillon?
I wanted to add a, thank you, sorry, through you, Mr. Mayor. I wanted to add a discussion on the Airport Taxi Association.
Okay.
So, Mr. Mayor, just for clarity, so we have a proposed item 14.1, which is correspondence from yourself from Carmen Spada regarding public piano in Ken Willen Square. There's additional correspondence from Councillor Willens, 14.2, regarding community gardens. There is an item added by Councillor Santos, 18.2, on active transportation strategy. There is a discussion item from Councillor Pelleschi, 18.3, on the CIP program. There is a discussion item from Councillor Fortini, 18.4, on swimming pools. A further discussion item from Councillor Fortini, 18.5, regarding change of use. And 18.6, a discussion item from Councillor Dillon on Airport Taxi Association.
Okay. Thank you.
Question, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Just with respect to 18.5, change of use, can we get an elaboration on that a little bit, please?
Does someone want to answer that question for Councillor Pelleschi? Councillor Fratini?
Yeah, thank you. It's about changing use when you have development charges are being paid. And what happens is, let's say one of the stores ends up closing and I decide to put something else there. If we're going to help the small businesses, they have to pay for the change of use. I did talk to staff about it. And I think we have to, if we want to keep these businesses coming, we have to do some changes to help them out.
So change of use in zoning?
In zoning.
Okay.
Okay, so we have a motion here from Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Fratini, to approve the agenda as amended. Is anyone opposed? If you don't state you're opposed, it will be assumed that you support the motion. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. As we continue to persevere in these extraordinary times, Council is now permitted to conduct its meetings electronically to support physical distancing and public gathering restrictions, while ensuring the business of the municipality can continue. Meetings of municipal councils are to be open to the public for transparency and accountability, and our meeting will continue to be as well, with a few precautions and limitations. In-person attendance at this meeting is severely restricted to members of council and essential city staff only. Members and most staff are participating electronically in this meeting. The public can still access and participate in the meetings by a few measures: watching this meeting remotely through the city's live stream, playback of the archive video system, submitting questions about the agenda, business, and decisions made by council today, emailing the city clerk's office at cityclerksoffice@brampton.ca with your question, which may be read into the public meeting record during the 15 minutes public question period before the end of the meeting. Also continue to follow important service and public health updates to the city's website, brampton.ca, which includes updated information on the city's response, as well as links to other important sources of information, including the Region of Peel Public Health, Province of Ontario, and the Government of Canada. A final reminder to members of council before we start to consider today's agenda business, please ensure your video is off and microphone is muted until you are assigned the floor. Then you can turn both on when you speak. This will help ensure that only one person is speaking at one time and minimize other background disruptions during the meeting. Number three, declarations of interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act. Does any member have a declaration of pecuniary interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act for any matter to be considered on today's agenda? Seeing none, the clerk will so note for the meeting minutes. We are now ready to move to the next item of public business on today's council agenda, item four, which is minutes. Minutes of the City Council regular meeting, April 29th, 2020. Councilor Santos asked on the instant messaging if we can add items into consent.
That will be after the
Okay, sure. So we have a motion moved by Councilor Williams and seconded by Councilor Fertini to approve the minutes as published. Are there any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries. That takes us to number five, consent motion. Since Councilor Santos, you were eager on this one, you get to go first.
Thank you, through you, Mr. Mayor. Just wanting to add 22.1 and 22.2, the in-camera minutes, into consent, please.
Okay. Are there any other items that members of council would like to put into consent?
Sorry, what were those items?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's 22.1 and 22.2. They are closed session minutes from the Committee of Council meeting of last week, May 6th, and the City Council meeting of April 29th.
Okay.
Okay. I have a motion from Councilor Madero, seconded by Councilor Bowman, to approve the consent motion. Any objections? Motion carries. We have no announcements on today's agenda. This takes us to government relations matters. I have a presentation from Gurdeep Kaur regarding today's government relations matters update. Gurdeep, presentation slides were published on the meeting's agenda last Friday. Do any members, I guess are we gonna do the presentation and then ask for questions or?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll have Gurdeep's presentation and then if anyone has questions, put your name in the instant messaging box.
Thank you.
The floor is yours, Gurdeep.
Thank you, and through the mayor. I will go quickly over some of the key government relations announcements and incentives from last week and provide relevant updates where available. Slide one, please. Thank you. On May the 4th, the Government of Canada joined other global leaders in launching the Coronavirus Global Response, an online pledging event with the goal of raising $8 billion to help researchers and innovators develop solutions to test, treat, and protect people, and to prevent the further spread of COVID-19. On May the 5th, the federal government announced an investment of more than $252 million to support farmers, food businesses, and food processes. The various incentives are listed on the slide. To support the effort to secure PPE, the federal government is waiving tariffs on certain medical goods, masks, and gloves. Last week, we were also monitoring the labor market that now shows employment decline of over 3 million people since the beginning of COVID-19. This is reflected in the high unemployment rate in April. Slide two, please. In other measures, the government announced that the Canada Emergency Wage Subsidy will be extended beyond June with more specific information to follow. The new Industry Strategy Council will provide the government with industry-specific information on how they have been impacted by COVID-19, announced additional information regarding the cultural heritage and sport organizations and how funding will be divided among select delivery partners. Slide three, please. This is an update from the provincial government. As part of Mental Health Week, the province highlighted various online mental health incentives to support services to patients and frontline workers listed on the slide. The province is continuing to announce further restrictions being eased on various retail stores and essential construction. This past Monday, businesses with public entrances that open onto street or exterior walkway can begin offering curbside pickup. In addition to the extension of various emergency measures, I wanted to note that the declaration of emergency was extended yesterday. I believe it's June 2nd or 6th, 2020. The province has also begun discussions to provide hospitals with clear criteria that must be met before hospitals resume scheduled surgeries. Slide five, please. I'd like to provide a region appeal update. The next region council meeting is scheduled for Thursday, May the 14th. While the next few slides provide you with a summary of some of the key items we flagged, I will focus on the following. Update 8.1 COVID-19 pandemic update. The path forward presentation will be by the CAO. overview of planning for gradual resumption of regional business lines with focus on improvements, adaptations, and innovations, three-phase approach to demobilizing and recovery. Update on 8.2-1, planning for the next phase of the COVID-19 pandemic. This is also a presentation, overview of provincial approach to gradual reopening, risks associated with reopening too quickly, key considerations for managing the infection risk, contact intensity, number of contacts, and modification potential. 8.5 is approach to development of the 2021 budget. On April the 9th, Regional Council deferred report on development of the 2021 budget, directing that the proposed timelines be revised to reflect the announcement of the provincial budget currently scheduled for November the 15th, 2020. A net regional tax levy increase forecasted for 2021 was of 4.3, with recognition that provincial grants and subsidies provide 25% of regional revenues. Due to the economic uncertainty caused by the pandemic, the report does not recommend a budget target at this time. The proposed date for 2021 budget deliberations is January the 28th, 2021, to enable staff to assess the provincial budget. Finance staff have no issues with regional recommendations. 8.6, the 2021 Development Charges Bylaw Update and Timeline Extension. The Coronavirus Support and Protection Act 2020 came into force on the 14th of April and provides that Peel's current Development Charges Bylaw stays in effect during the provincial emergency declaration period for 6 months and for 6 months thereafter. The extension allows staff to prepare the replacement bylaw to accommodate current economic realities and legislative changes from Bill 108. 8.7-1, community agencies are received of COVID-19 funding. As of May the 8th, 2020, COVID-19 Community Fund has provided $1.2 billion in funding to 65 agencies. Update on item 8.7-6, community agencies in receipt of COVID-19 funding update. Council approved $1 million in regional funding through the Community Investment Program to establish a COVID-19 emergency fund. Appendix 1 lists community agencies that were awarded funding. 26 Brampton community agencies are receiving support. 408 and 972 total funding for community agencies. 15.2, 2020 tax capping policy selection of options. Regional Council is required by legislation to pass the bylaw each year to apply one or more of the optional tools in calculating the amount of property taxes for properties in the commercial, industrial, and multi-residential cap property classes. Regional and local municipal finance staff endorse the continued application of all applicable optional tools enhancements to promote a fair property taxation system by moving toward full current value assessment tax levels. Staff comments on this, our preliminary analysis indicates that by adapting all of the optional tools, there will be only one property left in the capping for Ryan Brampton and only 15 across the region. This is significant progress and promotes fair taxation. Next slide, please. Thank you. Association of Municipalities of Ontario, AMO, has confirmed their 2020 annual conference will be virtual and has released a preliminary program that includes virtual delegation meetings. Full program details are expected to be available by July the 6th. It's expected that all cancellations and refunds for accommodations made through the AMO hotel block will be issued by June the 30th, 2020. Large Urban Mayors Caucus of Ontario update, LUMCO update. On May the 8th, LUMCO mayors had conversations with Federal Minister Ahmed Hussein, Families, Children, and Social Development, and Provincial Minister Steve Clark, Municipal Affairs and Housing, Rod Phillips, Finance, and Carolyn Manuni for transportation. Discussions focus on ensuring municipalities are engaged in conversations with the province as it continues to announce measures to slowly open the economy. The need for federal and provincial funding to offset impact COVID-19 is having on local communities. Funding through the Community Emergency Support Fund is expected to begin flowing to community agencies shortly. A very brief FCM update. Earlier this week, FCM announced a $10 million philanthropic donation from the Canadian Medical Association Foundation. This COVID-19 Community Response Fund for Vulnerable Populations will direct allocations to communities with homeless populations according to needs. Eligible communities will be contacted by FCM regarding their allocations, and we will follow up should the city or region be eligible for this funding. And at this time, I would like to invite Macau Mar, who will update us on the chair for the region appeal.
Thank you, Gurdeep. Through the chair, I'd like to share a brief verbal update from the region community response table. Just to build on Gurdeep's regional update, at tomorrow's Council of the Region Municipality of Peel meeting, regional staff will be presenting the report, item 8.7, community agencies in receipt of COVID-19 funding under the COVID-19 related matters section. This report provides a high-level overview to Regional Council outlining the process to determine the eligibility under the COVID-19 fund, a list of community agencies that have received this funding, and the purpose for which these funds were used. Just some background on that report. On April 23rd, 2020, a report titled COVID-19 Funding for the Most Vulnerable Responding to the Immediate Needs of the Community, Regional Council granted staff the authority to administer approximately $11.8 million in federal and provincial funding to respond to local needs. These needs include, but are not limited to, implementing regionally led programs directed to the homeless and continuing to issue grants and community agencies the support that they would need to help our vulnerable population. As of May 8th, 2020, the region received 87 applications requesting $4.9 million in funding support. To date, 65 of those applications have been approved, totaling $1.2 million. Of the 65 non-for-profits provided funding to date, 60% of the funding was distributed to the following service sectors: food security, service for families, children and youth at risk, and health and multi-service agencies. This report is currently on the region's website, and the funded agencies are also listed in the appendices. With regard to the community response table, we're now meeting twice per week on Wednesday and Friday, as opposed to three times, based on the feedback from the table members. We continue our discussions with the agencies and organizations regarding the identification of needs beyond the impact of COVID-19 pandemic, and are focusing on COVID-19 recovery phase and any emerging impacts to our vulnerable populations. With that, I conclude my updates. Thank you.
Gurdeep or Mikhail? Seeing no questions, we have a motion moved by Councillor Bowman, seconded by Councillor Medeiros, to receive the report and presentation. Is there anyone opposed? Seeing none, the motion carries. Our next item is 9.1 and an update on the COVID-19 emergency. So we've had another busy week, and thank you for everyone who continues to chip in. This morning, I did my weekly briefing on the COVID-19 efforts, and thank you to Councillor Vicente, who talked about some of the economic success stories, businesses that have transformed and stepped up to pitch in, whether it was Pack Polar doing these shields, or whether it is O2 Technologies doing the technology for the hospitals. It really is wonderful to see local companies who have changed their production to meet some of the needs we have during the pandemic. We continue to make progress, but we are, still a long way from beating this. Our medical officer health today talked about the fact that in parts of the province they're not seeing new cases, yet we continue to see new cases in the GTA, and so dense urban areas allow for transmission to happen more rapidly, and for that reason we need to continue to be on guard and continue to undertake our physical distancing measures. This is Victoria Day weekend. We talked that we're going to have a virtual fireworks celebration that will be on the city's website at brampton.ca/Victoria Day, so please spread the word that we're going to have our first ever digital fireworks celebration. I would note that I wrote the Minister of Municipal Affairs, Steve Clark, about stopping commercial rent evictions, because the first day for that is May 16th. We want to make sure that small businesses during this pandemic are not their efforts are not in vain. Right now, everyone's working so hard to keep their head above water, and an eviction right now would be very challenging. And small businesses are the heart of our economy. I also had the large urban mayors meeting this week that I attended, and we had the Greater Toronto area, Greater Toronto Hamilton area mayors meeting that I attended. There are similarities to the challenges in the GTA, and we all talked about the importance of municipal assistance that the provincial and federal governments need to provide in terms of the losses we're receiving for public goods. Right now, we're running transit systems to serve the national food supply, to help staff medical laboratories. We're running transit systems at a loss, and obviously there needs to be some collaboration with these costs. And there was unity amongst all mayors towards highlighting that we need this help. Public health costs are going to go up, and once again, we're helping with a critical service. And as municipalities can't run deficits, we require the provincial and federal participation. Mayor Tory in the Greater Toronto Hamilton Area's Mayor's Caucus also talked about making sure we follow the direction of public health and we don't feel pressure from some corners of the province or the country that may not have had the same interaction with COVID, because we certainly have in the GTA. And there's a real alignment on perspective there that we listen to public health. I would note we've continued our practice of supporting frontline workers every Friday. This Friday, thank you to Councillor Singh and Santos, who joined me as we dropped off some coffee from Segovia to our bylaw officers. Our bylaw team is doing incredible work, and we're grateful for their ongoing efforts. And they've been on the front lines ensuring that we abide by physical distancing, so a thank you to Paul Morrison and his team. The week before, we were at the paramedics, and Councillor Dillon and Singh were there for that, and grateful that everyone's finding different ways to pitch in. I would note that as part of my report today, we have a presentation from Claire Barnett on the Economic Support and Recovery Task Force. I'm just looking to the clerk, would that be done during this COVID-19 emergency section? Okay, so maybe before we get to questions, why don't we do the economic support and recovery motion that I've been putting forward, seconded by Councillor Vicente and Pelleschi. And I've had the chance to listen in to their conference calls, and they've done some conference calls with 500 small businesses and with the Board of Trade and the Downtown Business Association. But really, it's Councillor Pelleschi and Vicente who have taken the lead on this. And I want to thank them for their dedication, and declare who continues to do a great job for us in economic development. So if Claire is on the line, why don't you give an update on our task force recommendations on economic support and recovery, and then Councillor Vicente and Pelleschi, if you want to add anything to that, of course, we would welcome that. Do we have Claire on the line?
Yes, I'm here. Thank you, Mayor. We have a presentation that Charlotte's just going to put up, and I'll walk through some of the work that we've been doing. We can go to the next slide, please, Charlotte. I'd like to acknowledge the work of the members of the task force. I think it's very important to focus and to highlight on the diversity that we had in terms of membership of the task force. Certainly we had representatives, senior representatives from the Canadian and provincial government. Very grateful to the participation and advice from Todd Letts from the Brampton Board of Trade and Susie from the BIA, as well as Christina. We also have representatives from various chambers of commerce that really speak to the diversity of Brampton and our business community. So I would like to acknowledge that many were on the task force as well, and we had private sector representation from all sizes of businesses as well. So wanted to acknowledge and thank them for their guidance and their direction as we put together our economic recovery strategy. Next slide, please. The recovery strategy really aims to bring resiliency and a competitive advantage to Brampton's economy. And the goals of this is really achieved by advancing four cornerstones of the strategy, each of which have an immediate and long-term impact with projects and action items. Next slide, please. The four cornerstones include innovation, technology, and entrepreneurship. Technology and entrepreneurship really speak to the innovation district and the goals of bringing an innovation and economy to Brampton, but it also speaks to supporting businesses to adopt new technology. We have seen around the world that businesses who have adopted technology have really fared better than others. So we want to ensure that we also talk about innovation and technology when it comes to larger enterprises. Infrastructure, we need to make sure that all of the infrastructure projects that are advanced through the city and through council really have an economic development lens. Historically, as many of you will know, infrastructure projects have really brought about job creation, and this pandemic will be no different. We will look to see what economic benefits we can garner from infrastructure projects. Investment speaks to advancing our business retention and expansion work, foreign direct investment. But also, it's important that we acknowledge our partnership on the arts, culture, and tourism file. As people aren't able to travel around the world, they can certainly come and experience that in Brampton. All of this is tied together and is seen through the lens of talent and diversity. We need to ensure that we continue to develop the pipeline of talent through initiatives such as Brampton University and our three university partners. And also diversity, that we look at all of the projects that we work on through an international and diverse lens. Next slide, please. Before I pass it over to the councillors to provide their comments as well, I wanted to acknowledge that the cornerstones are really forward-looking. These are the cornerstones that will guide our work through the recovery from the pandemic, which will take years to recover from it. Some businesses will need our help as they open up again. Larger businesses will need our help to ensure that their workers are safe. Smaller businesses will need our help to pivot their operations. Many businesses in Brampton, smaller ones on Main Street, will need to digitize. So we want to make sure that although we are speaking of large infrastructure projects and virtual missions and that type of thing, that we do focus on the immediate requirements of businesses as they reopen. So some examples would be under the innovation, technology, and partnership initiatives that we are going to launch our innovation district. We are very excited to be participating at Collision at Home, which is a large tech-based, tech-focused conference that, as many will know, we participated in person, and we're very excited to be part of its first digital launch with tens of thousands of people participating. We are also going to pivot the Entrepreneur Center to focus primarily on Main Street businesses, to support them as they're opening up, and really rely on our partners such as Sheridan Edge program to help with the entrepreneurs that are more tech focused. And as I mentioned, we will be looking at tech adoption, looking at the current government programs from the federal and the provincial government that help Brampton businesses adopt new technology and really pivot their operations. There are existing programs that we want to make sure those businesses are aware of. On the infrastructure cornerstone, we will be ready with shovel-ready projects for when the federal government come forward with any stimulus infrastructure projects. And we are thrilled to start moving forward with Algoma's Brampton campus expansion downtown. That is a significant investment, and we have been working hand-in-hand with them, and we really look forward to welcoming that economic impact downtown especially. From an infrastructure perspective, we will be launching a support local campaign next week, really looking through the diversity lens, as I mentioned, and we're very excited to start that next week. As I mentioned, we will launch that. And we will be launching virtual missions. We will be calling on companies in the US to start their headquarters of Brampton businesses to ensure that Brampton is part of the conversation as they look to reevaluate their international presence, but also supply chains, that Brampton is part of that conversation. And we continue to work on the community improvement plans. Now there is a much greater need for us to move that quickly and to really look at the existing CIP to ensure that we are addressing development quickly as well. And the fourth cornerstone, as I had mentioned, arts, culture, and tourism. As you mentioned, Mayor, we are already looking at virtual delivery of various programs, and it's exciting to see that Victoria Day is already one of those programs that we will be launching virtually. I'm excited to see what augmented reality fireworks actually look like. So I will leave it at that. I will pass it over to the Councillor Vicente and Puleshi if you wanted to add any other comments.
Councillor Puleshi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to really quickly, and Claire did an excellent job in outlining this, but I wanted to let everybody know that when, like typical, when we're talking about any plan that the City of Brampton is creating, and hopefully all members of council can support this going forward, it's a workable, changeable plan. It's not set in stone. We're able to keep it on the desk and reference it and go to it and make changes as those changes are needed and as they come up. So it took a lot of effort from ECDEV and also members of the task force to put this together. And if somebody is going through the plan and doesn't see something necessarily outlined in the plan, trust me, when we created this plan, it encompasses everything, and just because you don't see it in there doesn't mean it's not, and it's not what we're talking about. The other thing that I wanted to mention about this plan, we heard a lot over the past, say, 5 years from other levels of government. They were saying to the city that we weren't providing them with the shovel-ready projects. We had heard that a few times, although we disagreed at that time. This clearly states that those shovel-ready programs will be sent to them, and not only I think will it be sent to them, but they're going to be so sick of us sending it to them that they're never going to say that we've never sent it to them before. So, I know Councillor Vicente has also some words on this, and thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Vicente.
Thank you so much, Mayor. Thank you, Councillor Puleshi, and a big thank you to Claire and staff at Economic Development for all of the hard work that they're doing on this file. This is something that we have taken the opportunity during this crisis to consult with all of our partners, residents, and the businesses here in the City of Brampton. We have such a young and diverse population, very talented group of people that live here in the City of Brampton. And as we all know, about 60% of them leave the city every day to go work elsewhere. And we want to change that paradigm. We want to bring more people to be able to work here closer to home. So our economic development work is so important. We have the space here in Brampton to attract new business, and we have a very innovative and resilient business scene here already. And when Claire touched upon our post-secondary potential with our existing partners like Algoma, Ryerson, and Sheridan College, and also our work, the work that we're doing to develop Brampton U, which would be a game changer here for the City of Brampton. The province has encouraged us to continue working on that file, and so staff are working diligently to refine that and to define it clearly. In terms of our infrastructure, like so many other municipalities all across the country, we have a lot of infrastructure projects that are ready to go. We talk all the time about the infrastructure deficit that exists here in Brampton, but also across the country. So we're ready. When the government is ready to fund our projects, we are ready to implement them. And I'm happy to hear that municipal governments around the country are starting to talk not just about shovel-ready projects, but also shovel-worthy projects, projects that will help the federal and provincial governments achieve their goal of kickstarting the economy and getting things moving again. So we are ready in that sense. And not to forget our arts and culture file. Arts and culture here in the city of Brampton is a big priority. Since the demise of the Arts Council, we have been working to develop a new arm's length organization, and I continue to look forward to staff bringing that forward and giving us the decision points so that we can move that file along. So there's a lot of potential here in the city. We have a lot going for us. We have a great city, and we can come out of this very strong indeed. So thank you to everyone, and I look forward to seeing the motion.
Thank you, Councilor Vicente. I know there's a number of councillors that want to speak on COVID-19 directly. Are there any comments specifically on this motion? I see we have Councillor Dillon, Fortini, and Bowman asking to speak. There'll be opportunities to speak to COVID-19, but we'll start off with this particular motion. Councillor Dillon, do you want to speak to the economic recovery strategy?
No, is this a general general comment on COVID?
So we'll keep you first on the other list. Councillor Fortini?
I just wanted to ask some questions. That's fine. Not on this motion.
Okay. Councillor Bowman on this motion?
No, not specific to this.
Okay,
motion.
So why don't we put this motion forward then, and then we can move on to the other COVID matters. Are there any objections to the motion moved by myself, Councillor Pelleschi, and Vicente to support economic support efforts?
Recorded vote, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, record a vote to the clerk.
Recorded vote. All in favor of the motion as shown on the screen. Councillor Santos.
Yes.
Councillor Vicente.
Yes.
Councillor Willens.
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Yes.
Councillor Bowman.
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros.
Yes.
Councillor Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Fortini.
Yes.
Councillor Singh.
Yes.
Councillor Dillon.
Yes.
And Mayor Brown.
Yes.
Yes. That carries unanimously 11 to 0.
Okay. Now we'll go back to the original COVID-19 list. We
Councillor Santos was on the list first.
Oh, Councillor Santos on the list first?
Yeah.
Yes, Councillor Santos, update from the Social Support Task Force, a motion regarding SHARPs in downtown area.
Thanks so much. Through you, Mr. Mayor, I won't take too much time here. Last week, the Social Support Task Force had a meeting, and our anchor organizations, as well as the members on the Social Support Task Force, brought up a growing concern during this COVID-19 time. So unsafe disposal of SHARPs near the downtown core and along the trail corridor has always been an issue in Brampton. It has significantly worsened because many of the safe disposal containers located in various agencies as well as community centers are shut down. And so the folks who are using are disposing them in encampment sites as well as other areas throughout the downtown core. Rasmeen Saeed and her team put together a briefing note for us on Monday. I forwarded that over to councillors so they could take a look. Unfortunately, during this time, it's creating a very dangerous public health and safety issue. And therefore, in working with staff yesterday and Monday, so thank you, Mikel Marr, as well as Jason Keddy from security, we have confirmed that there is an increase of unsafe SHARPs being disposed of at encampment areas as well as other areas in downtown Brampton. And we put forward a motion today from the Social Support Task Force, as well as all of the councillors from downtown Brampton, that would be Councillor Medeiros, Bowman, and Councillor Vicente, to support this motion. The Region of Peel has been notified, so Councillor Medeiros and I are bringing this up at the Region tomorrow, and so their staff are aware as well. So we are working with the Region on this one. The motion is before you, and I would ask for everyone's support on this. Thank you.
Councillor Williams?
Hi, thank you so much for bringing this forward. I think it's really important that we look at all of the reasons that are surrounding the increase in the use of sharps right now. So, you know, I think with the closure, because there are only five needle exchange programs in Brampton, and are all five of those needle exchange programs closed at this time? This question to the staff. Hello? Can anybody hear me?
I can hear you, Charmaine.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Charmaine, it's Councillor Santos here. According to the briefing note, the five are currently closed right now, as far as we know. But if Rasmeen or Mikkel, if you have any clarification, that would be great.
Rasmeen?
Hi, through the chair. Just wanted to let the Peel Needle Exchange is still open at this moment, and the other organizations are functioning at a different capacity, but they are still, the services are available. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Rasmeen, for that. So they are currently open, but just obviously with less hours. And I understand that the van that is the mobile unit is still operating. And so, you know, with the van, it operates Monday to Saturday, and you know, it doesn't open on Sundays, and I wonder if that is an area that we can, you know, you can bring to the region to encourage during this time, if the other needle exchange programs are operating at a lower capacity, if the van can at least operate on Sundays to increase more opportunities for people to safely discard their sharps, and also if possible even getting a second van, because one van to service the whole region, it really is clearly showing that our resources are stretched quite thin. And also, when it comes to the receptacles for disposal, is that covered by the region to pay for those receptacles, or is the city going to be covering the cost of those?
Who wants to answer that question? Rasmeen?
Through the chair, I believe that I think that Councillor Santos will be bringing this motion to the region tomorrow, and I believe they'll be having a conversation about it, about which solution to use specifically.
Yeah, thank you, Rasmeen. So that therefore be it resolved, it says that staff engage with Region of Peel to collaboratively address the risk within Brampton impacting our vulnerable populations and create an action plan to address this growing concern during the COVID-19 pandemic. So based on that, the suggestions from Councillor Williams certainly would be covered. We have spoken to regional staff in the past about having an additional ongoing discussion, but during this time right now, based on what we have heard from our anchor organizations, there has been a significant increase in the number of unsafely disposed of sharps in Brampton. So we're just trying to address this need now, and then moving forward, we have here that staff will report back to council meeting on May 27th in terms of the progress of these actions.
And that's great. I want to encourage staff, when you're having your discussions with the region, the City of Cambridge has come up with a really great alternative to those yellow bins. I know when I used to work in the field, the yellow bins were a deterrent for many, and often felt that, you know, when they use those bins, they may as well have a sign on their back that says that I'm an opioid user. So the City of Cambridge, they have receptacles that look similar to the garbage bins that dispose of recycling and waste. So it might be good to look at what some of the other cities are doing to encourage people to use the receptacles as an option. And I think this is a really great initiative. And I think as we are, you know, progressing through the pandemic, you know, many are going to be feeling the stress and are going to be looking for ways to cope. So it's great. And I look forward to hearing some of the feedback, and especially if we can just at least acknowledge the need for another van or increasing the time that the vans are able to do their rounds and to provide for those needle exchanges during the time that those other operations are operating at a smaller capacity. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Willens.
Yes, thank you through you, Mr. Mayor. I've worked with Daniels Health in Brampton here on another project a number of years ago. I do know that those bins are expensive. They're about $3,300 a bin. So if we can get an idea also, I mean, I'm not against it, but I just, if we can get an idea of how many bins you think we'll need in the downtown, and I guess if this is going to go through procurement, or is the region going to look after it, if that comes back and report, that'd be great, because these things aren't cheap. So just keep that in mind. Thanks.
Okay. Seeing no other comments, we have a motion on the floor moved by Councillor Santos and seconded by Councillor Medeiros and Bowman and Councillor Vasante. Are there any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries. That takes us to...
Councillor Dillon is on to
Councillor Dillon and then Councillor Fortini, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Councillor Dillon.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. I just want to give a quick update on a town hall we had this morning, in a South Asian town hall, seniors town hall, in regards to some of the issues that some of the South Asian seniors are having. And I'll be very brief as well with the update. But some of the concerns people had was there was not enough input from some of the ethnic communities in the town halls we have for the seniors task force. And so just real quick, some of the issues that they mentioned today were mental health and isolation, the need for sanitizers and masks. A lot of them had said, you know, they are not qualified for CPP because there's too many precarious jobs in Brampton, and so they're unable to get some full-time work. They also said they want to look at introducing video conferencing for some of the seniors clubs, having a hotline at that when we reopen the city. This is probably directed to Councillor Medeiros that we should be including the seniors clubs as well. So all really good points, and we'll be sure to make sure that these notes get directed to the seniors task force. And I'd like to thank Red FM 88.9 for hosting it today.
Okay, Councillor Fortini.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mine was for economical development. Is Claire still on the line?
Yes, I'm here.
Thank you. So I did support the motion. That was good. I want to thank you and the staff, Councillor Pileschi, Vincente, and the mayor for a great job you guys are doing. My question is going back to these businesses, and I think we had a discussion on it. As we all know, Revenue Canada taxes are way down. HST, because people are not shopping besides groceries, and you don't pay the HST on that and taxes. How are we going to help these businesses for their rents when a lot of these box places didn't apply through the government grant, and they're asking for full rent? So a lot of these businesses are going to end up closing. I know we have maybe some of the community grants, I guess we're not giving out, or with also some money put aside for traveling. That's been all canceled. Maybe we could see if we had to look into that. My main question is, I'm going to bring this up now, as before, about change of use. So if we want some of these businesses to come back, or new businesses, the problem is when these businesses come and let's say there's a donut shop there and I want to open a restaurant, I have to pay the change of use. They don't have the money to do it. So maybe if we could look into 1 year all across Brampton for small businesses like stores or donut shops or hair salon to not charge the change of use, because it's already hard times. And if these guys have to start paying these businesses a change of use and start paying thousands of dollars for that, they're not going to bother opening, and a lot of stores are going to be empty. So I don't know if we need a motion to do that. And I know Council Medeiros, we mentioned this last term about the change of use, but we have to help these businesses, and because some of them are now applying for that grant, and the landlords want full rent, because they might have a Scotiabank, let's say, and a TD Bank and a Metro there, they're not going to worry about two little stores applying for that and losing their 25% on the other part. So I don't know if we should put a motion forward or get a report back next council on this change of use just for 1 year to help them out, to hoping to return. It's not that business, it's another business to come in.
So is that a motion we have on the floor, seconded by Councillor Medeiros, to have a staff report back on this for the next council meeting?
Yes, please, Mr. Mayor, because, you know, we got to help them out. And I think that's the only way we're going to help them, if we want to fill up these stores back, you know. And I'm only talking about now stores. I'm not talking industrial. A lot of these box stores like donut shop, hair salons, daycares, whatever, you know, if we got to start changing change of use, I think we're not going to have these businesses back. They're already suffering now. And like I said, if you look at the thing with like Revenue Canada, the taxes are all down, HST is way down. So the provincial government hit the 40% already, 40 billion. And once you go over the 40%, you know, we're going to go in a recession. And then I like the government could borrow money anytime. Thank you.
Okay. Councilor Medeiros, on this point.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, just to thank Councillor Fortini for bringing this forward. And at the time when we talked about this in last term of council, and I know the whole idea why we held off on doing anything, it was part of our sort of official plan review. It was part of a review which was going to come at a later date. I know we did make some tweaks to it, but I think from the urgency in which we're going through now, and if staff can bring some thought around it, because it is desperately, especially those who own a lot of these type of facilities or these type of box, these warehouses, not warehouses, sorry, these plazas and so on. And I know that some of the difficulties that they're going to be having to collect rent and be able to get that business out. And understanding that this will be, again, part of a overall sort of a larger plan on what we do with change of uses, because it is outdated. Even the industrial uses, I wouldn't mind having looked at as well. But I guess for this time being, I'll let staff come back with what they find that we can do immediately. Thank you.
Councillor Plushy.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Councillor Fortini and Councillor Medeiros as well. You know, we've been talking about this a little bit at the task force already, and typically whenever we're having discussions with, you know, we call them mom and pop shops or small businesses, they really have a choice to make in with respect to what they're going to do during this whole COVID pandemic. Some that try and pivot to accommodate and try and make their business last. It's a very difficult situation, especially when they're talking about you know, the loans that the government is providing. Now, some businesses have taken advantage of those loans, but some businesses have decided, because they're, you know, living paycheck to paycheck, just having their business thrive as much as possible, have decided that they're just going to walk away from it for now, and maybe restart up once this is all completed. So this is a good opportunity. We're having those discussions now on the task force, but I look forward to having ECTEV planning and any other part of the city come back with a report to see how we can use. And it's not just change of use. It's a matter of how we help these businesses that couldn't continue during this this tragedy, and how we're able to help them flourish in the city of Brampton going forward once we're through this. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, I know we had Councillor Bowman on the list. Did we skip over him accidentally?
We'll come back to him on another.
Okay, Councillor Vasanti on this side. Councillor Fortini on this item.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi. Yeah, I agree. Just a question to Claire. when we have these big plazas, and I know that a lot of people apply for this grant for 50% from the federal, and they lose 25%, and 25% is charged on the rent. Well, how can we help these big plazas where there's, let's say, I'm giving you an example, Scotiabank, a TD Bank, and there's a Metro, and there's only two little variety stores, a hair salon and a cleaners, and the owner does not apply for the grant because he doesn't want to lose the 25% on everything. And those people are expected to pay full rent, and they can barely survive now. Do we have anything to help those two little individuals? Can they apply on their own, or they, it has to be up to the owner to apply for the whole grant program for the whole plaza or the whole mall?
So we are expecting some change in the eligibility criteria from the federal government, but we don't know what that will entail, so I can't speak to that. But what I can say is that the city has done what it can to this point, and in fact the mayor this morning on CP24 did speak to this issue and sent a letter to the Ontario government advocating for a ban on commercial evictions during the COVID emergency period. So that's one issue that businesses, small businesses, as you're speaking about, are really very, very concerned about, the potential of an eviction. So that's one area. And we are also advocating for landlords to see what they can do in terms of coming up with arrangements with their tenants, whether it is a new lease. I know the CFIB has put out on their website new templates that landlords can use to come up. So there's a lot of things like that that can help. But what I can encourage businesses to do is to get in touch with us at Economic Development, and we can try and help facilitate some of this information sharing. But I think we did a good service this morning with what the mayor did with the media.
Yeah, thank you. And I didn't hear that, but I thank the mayor for that. I'm just worried because what happens is when these big plazas come along, you got these big box stores, they don't apply because they don't want to lose that 25%. And if it's one individual, Max Milk or a cleaners or a hair salon, they're not going to worry about them. If they have a lease, some of these bigger plazas are taking advantage, hoping they leave. That way they'll rather keep it empty and release it again for a higher price in the future. So, you know, once these stores close and someone's in the over the 50s, I don't think so they're going to come back and invest money again to open a start up a business all over again. It's very hard when you take a hit at a certain age and say, well, I got a little bit of savings, I'm going to start all over again. You know, that would be very hard. So that's why I was saying if we could do it, I'm hoping maybe the provincial government or the federal will help these small business, and they should be applying on their own, not leave it up to the owner of the mall to go into that. Because if you have, like I say, if you have only one salon or one variety store, and you have big box other stores, they're not going to worry about that little guy. And those little guys is what we need. Okay, thank you, and thank you to the mayor for bringing this forward.
Councilor Basanta.
Thank you, through you, Chair, to the mover of the motion. Would it be possible for us to amend the motion? Because I get the sense, Councillor Fertini, that you would like to see this happen fairly quickly so that we can provide, as soon as possible, relief for businesses that are thinking of locating within addresses here in Brampton. Can we put that this report come back to Council perhaps for May 27th, end of this month, as this is urgent?
I did say next council meeting, so.
But if that could be in the motion, I think that would be appropriate.
Yeah, I agree. Like, this is urgent, and thank you, Councillor Vincente. That's why I wanted next, give 2 weeks' time, and hoping how we could do for the change of use. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm okay with it.
Okay, no more speakers, so we're back to Councillor Bowman. Oh, take a vote on this item first. Okay, the motion moved by Councillor Fertini, but it says on the screen here, Dylan. It should.
It's below that.
Oh, sorry. Moved by Councillor Fertini, seconded by Councillor Medeiros. All those, are there any objections? No objections, the motion carries. Now, finally, we get to Councillor Bowman. Thank you for your patience.
Yeah, no problem through you, Mr. Mayor. First of all, I just want to confirm this was a motion that was added to the agenda, so we're not going to be talking about this motion later in the agenda when it comes up from Councillor Fortini. Is that correct?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, that is correct because Council's taken up the item already.
Okay, thank you. Just to confirm that. My point, Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to give a big shout out to the military personnel who are currently at Grace Manor. I was there on Saturday night when they had a little drive-by of military vehicles and some of our emergency personnel. It was amazing to see the residents were on their balconies clanging pots and pans and things like that as the shift changed and the 25 people who were working came out, and 25 new ones were going in, so they were all there. Quite a thing to see, and I just wanted to publicly thank them. And I just want to make sure that, you know, we're loosening up here, we're allowing more things to open, but I still don't want to lose track that in our seniors' facilities, we've got two of them, for instance, in Brampton that have almost 100 cases, where 17 people have died already, one employee has died, and I don't want to lose I don't want to lose the importance that, you know, we still have a huge issue to deal with in our seniors' residences and with the senior population. So I know that it's great that people want to get out. I know that it's great we want to go to the parks and everywhere, but we still need to keep a focus that our seniors are still very, very, very susceptible to this as we move forward. So thanks to the armed forces, and just a reminder to everybody to keep their distance, especially when seniors are involved. Thanks.
Okay, so we have the motion on the screen now from Councillor Dillon and Councillor Singh. And this is just to accept the report for the COVID-19 emergency. Any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries, which takes us to reports from corporate officials. Do we have a report from the CAO? I don't think so. We'll go ahead to item number 10, technological options for virtual council and committee meetings. Do any members have questions or comments regarding the staff report? If so, use your instant messaging. Seeing no no one wants to speak to it. We have a motion moved by Councillor Dillon, seconded by Councillor Singh to receive the staff report. Any objections? There are none. Motion carries. Item 10.2 was dealt with in consent. Item 10.3 was dealt with in consent. Item 10.4 was dealt with in consent. That takes us to number 12. Committee reports or minutes. We have two committee reports in the form of minutes or recommendations on today's agenda. Under Council's meeting procedures, the committee or section chair introduces a committee report or minutes and summarizes the matters considered and now brought forward on Council today for ratification. The Audit Committee held a special meeting on May 5th to consider the 2019 audited financial statements. The committee minutes are here for Council's consideration and approval. Councilor Medeiros led the Council consideration. Councilor Medeiros? Yeah, are there any questions for Councillor Medeiros? Seeing none, we have the motion moved by Councillor Medeiros and Santos. Are there any objections? The motion carries. That takes us to item 12.2, Committee of Council met on May 6th. The committee minutes are here for Council's consideration and approval. And we have the following chairs. Councillor Vicente chaired the Economic Development and Culture section. Councillor Singh chaired the Corporate Services section. Councillor Vicente chaired the Public Works and Engineering section. Councillor Santos chaired the Community Services section. Council then can consider a motion to approve the recommendations in its entirety after all section chairs have concluded their summaries. So, Councillor Vicente? Any questions?
If members of Council have any questions on the committee minutes. Seeing none, Mayor, back to you.
Okay, Councillor Singh?
Any questions? Do any members have any questions? Seeing none, I pass it on back.
Councillor Santos?
Thank you, through you, Mayor. Any members of Council have any questions regarding community services section? Seeing none, over to you.
Now, Councillor Vicente also chaired the Public Works. I think you asked for those questions, but any questions for Councillor Vicente on that one as well? Hearing none, we have a motion moved by Councillor Vicente, seconded by Councillor Singh to approve the committee minutes. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Okay, item 14.1, we have a letter in our correspondence from Carmen Spada. Carmen Spada and Councillor Willens have been working on an initiative to have a public piano in Ken Willens Square, which I think is beautiful in our ongoing efforts to encourage arts and culture in the downtown. And so this would be a donated piano that Councillor Willens and Carmen have helped arranged. And so I would just like to see where this goes, and maybe we can get the Kelly Stahl or a representative from our cultural department to work with them on how this could be incorporated into the city. And I'm told that there's a way that it could be brought in for storage in the winter. I don't know much about how you keep a piano outdoors, but I thought the offer from Carmen and Councillor Willens was generous, and I love the fact they're always looking at ways to bring more joy to our downtown. So if we could have get a staff report back on this, that how we could bring this into the downtown. I see Councillor Santos wrote, "I want to play it." I don't think that's a question, but thank you for the comment. Are there any questions about this?
I just have a comment.
Yes, Councillor Willens.
I'd like to thank you and Carmen for bringing this forward. I do have the piano, and if you read through the correspondence, there's a history on the piano, so maybe just take some time and read through it. Okay, thanks.
And thank you, Councillor Willens, for your family's dedication to the city, and obviously that's a very special square for your family to have Ken's keys there, and continuing to add, there's a lot of events that happen in Ken Willens Square, and I know you care a lot about it, and your family cares a lot about it, so thank you for your interest. It's a great idea. Councillor Pileschi wants to know if there's any germs on the piano. Councillor Willens, I don't think there's any germs, and we'll make sure it's sanitized. So if there are no other questions, are there any objections by the motion moved by myself and Councillor Willens? Seeing none, the motion carries.
Next item is 14.2,
correspondence on community gardens. Councillor Willens, you're up.
Yeah, this is just for a council's read. I won't take some time on it. It's an interesting read. It was a report by Princeton University, so I'll just leave it at that. I've highlighted I put bold print on the parts that are worth reading. So that's all. I'll let the councillors read about it, and they can discuss with me later if they like.
And thank you, Councillor Willens. Just to reiterate the obvious, but we keep on having cities across the country replicate Brampton's backyard garden program, and that was your idea. So you continue to make Brampton proud with the success of that program. And so, that's interesting correspondence. We need a motion for the correspondence, moved by Councillor Willens, seconded by Councillor Santos to receive the correspondence. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. I think Councillor Pileschi wants to know whether there's an added correspondence on the CIP.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, that is added as a new business item, so that's under 18, and we will get to that in the order of business.
This takes us to item 16.
Yes, 16.1.
We have 16.1, Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Madeiro's proposed national gun back program and assault style firearms ban. Councillor Williams, you have the floor because you introduced the motion.
Yes, hi, thank you. I was encouraged by the announcement made by Prime Minister Trudeau and Minister Bill Blair and their plan to ban 1,500 assault style.
So one second, Councillor Williams, we have a point of order from Councillor Willens.
Yeah, just quickly, and maybe the clerk can clarify it. I don't think there's a need for discussion on this because this is not coming forward. That's the purpose of this. This is done properly by doing a notice of motion, and that gives us time to review it and research it, look into it, and then we can discuss it when it comes forward at a future meeting. I believe that's the procedure, isn't it, Peter?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it can be if it's filed with that intent. If a notice of motion is properly filed with a mover and seconder by the 4:30 Tuesday deadline, the week prior to a meeting, as this motion was, as is the next motion, then they are properly before council as they are today, and they can be properly debated. So it is on the floor for council. It's a proper notice of motion for council's consideration today, should they so choose.
Okay, thank you. I'll listen to the councillors then. Thank you. Okay.
The floor is yours again, Councillor Williams.
Thank you. So I was quite encouraged by the Prime Minister Trudeau and Minister Blair's announcement to ban 1,500 assault-style type weapons and to offer a national gun buyback program during the two-year amnesty period to April 30th, 2022. So in Canada, there are over 100,000 restricted firearms amongst the models that are now prohibited, and approximately 8,000 that are owned by residents in the region of Peel who will be looking to receive fair compensation for their firearms. And now I know there are strong opinions on the matter of firearm ownership, but many residents want to see initiatives that will make them feel safer, and I couldn't agree more. So I have a motion that is seconded by Councillor Medeiros that reads as follows: whereas assault style firearms designed for battlefield have been used tragically to target women, students, and worshippers because they are efficient in maximizing fatalities. And whereas residents of the City of Brampton have been victims of mass shootings, and whereas the City of Brampton will be commemorating the 45th anniversary of the mass shooting of 15 people on May 28, 2020, and whereas the words of Justice Minister Dave Lametti, weapons designed for battlefield have no place on our streets or in our communities, and whereas the federal government has added 1,500 assault-style firearms to the list of prohibited firearms, and whereas in Canada there are currently over 100,000 restricted firearms amongst the models that are now prohibited, and this number does not include other newly prohibited models that are not subject to registration requirements, and whereas a criminal code amnesty is in place until April 30th, 2022 to protect lawful owners from criminal liability and to enable them to comply with the law. Under the amnesty, the newly prohibited firearms can only be transferred or transported within Canada for specific purposes. And whereas firearm owners should be fairly compensated for their property, and whereas the federal government has announced preliminary plans to compensate firearms owners through a national gun buyback plan. Therefore, be it resolved that Brampton City Council endorsed the recently announced proposed national gun buyback program and assault-style firearms ban. And I would like a recorded vote, please.
Okay, are there any comments on this? Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor. So very quickly, on March 27th, 2019, we had a very heated discussion about gun buyback programs and banning firearms, and part of that discussion actually included the need for a comprehensive approach and advocating for a comprehensive approach from the federal government, in which this really lies in their jurisdiction. So it's quite encouraging to see the federal government taking this particular step. But in addition to that meeting that we had on March 27th, 2019, the other piece of our guns issue in Brampton and across the GTHA province and country is actually the illegal smuggling of guns across the border. And when we debated it last year in the spring, we put a lot of emphasis on the root causes of gun violence to include advocacy to the federal government with respect to gun smuggling. So I think I'm fine to endorse this because at the end of the day, this is federal jurisdiction, and it's nice to see the Fed stepping up to the plate on this one, but I think we do need to see a lot more. So I would put that forward as an amendment based on our discussions in the past about advocating to the federal government to come up with a comprehensive approach that includes dealing with illegal smuggling of firearms across the border.
Okay, Councillor Pelosi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I heard the announcement, and I wasn't fully clear on what this actually meant for the municipalities and who is going to be taking charge in this. Is there any of that information that has come out?
Councillor Williams?
I'm sorry, I thought it was going to staff. Can you repeat the question? If there are...
So who's going to be taking charge of the buyback program? Where do people go to drop off their guns? How much is being, if there's a price or if there's a dollar amount that's going to be given to people to drop off their guns, and who is going to be paying that cost?
Well, right now it would be all firearms that are going to be handed in would go to our Peel Regional Police, and the compensation portion, that discussion is ongoing at a federal level, and it is up for us to say loud and clear to the province and to the federal government how many firearms we have in the city of Brampton, and you know, advocate for fair compensation. And so that is what the motion is speaking to as well, fair compensation for the firearms that are currently here in the city of Brampton, or region of Peel rather, and to make sure our residents do get that compensation. So those details are still being worked out.
Okay. So we don't have all the details as of yet. The Region of Peel is going to be the ones that are taking it in. Peel Regional Police are going to be the ones that are taking in the guns for the buyback program. And they might have an estimated cost to administer that. Is any of that money going to be paid by the federal government?
Yes, correct. The federal government will be looking at the sum to be given to the province, which will then filter down to our police, Peel Regional Police, for the buyback. Right now, we are just endorsing in principle, and as the discussions happen, I think it's important that we make sure that we are advocating for the residents who do have firearms in Brampton, because the last thing we want to see are firearms ending up being sold illegally in the black market, becoming a problem further.
Okay, and further to that, do we know how many illegal guns out there that are being sold by people in the region that lawfully owned that gun prior to it being sold? And do we know how many guns are actually coming over the border?
Well, at this time, I know the federal government is looking at the firearms that are coming over the border, and they have been looking at strategies to make sure that we are dealing with the smuggling. I know it is a major issue that the Chief of Police has addressed on numerous occasions. But as for, you know, like currently right now, this motion is just speaking to the announcement and endorsing that plan, that the federal government will be funding the full cost for the firearms that are currently here that need to be handed back in. Because after April 30th, 2022, those guns will be prohibited.
So I guess my last comment and question may be that this is endorsing a plan that we don't have before us as of yet. If they were to come out to say, you know, the rebates are going to be, you know, $50 or $25, and it's not anywhere close to fair market value, then I'm not sure how we then support a plan that currently has it's what sounds like a lot of work to be done and associated with it.
Yeah, the federal MPs can answer those questions, and we are just endorsing the ban and the buyback plan. And, you know, this also sends a message that we want to continue in conversation and that we as a council are advocating for our residents.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi, for your...
Okay, so sorry, Mr. Mayor, then in that case, if the information is out there and I don't have it, and if anybody else does have that information and would like to share it now, that would be great. If nobody does, then maybe we should get that information prior to us supporting the plan.
Councillor Pelleschi, are you suggesting a deferral until we have that the numbers from the federal government of what the funding would be?
I'm asking if anybody, I guess maybe in the CAO's office, do we know or understand, any of the questions that have been asked in relation to the plan?
David Barrick.
Thank you, Mayor. To the councillor, I think it's something that we would have to follow up with our respective community partners.
Okay, so then, there's a couple other people that wanted to speak, but maybe what I would do is just have members think about the possibility of having this come back once that information comes to members of council.
Okay, and Councillor Pelleschi, what I could add as a member of the Police Services Board and as someone that is part of the GTA Mayor's and Police Chief's caucus, that we do have a standing request to the federal government to help us with the smuggling at the border. We haven't got that help yet, just so you know, because someone mentioned that I think the federal government's working on it. They may be working on it, we haven't got that help yet. About 80% of the weapons used in Peel have been smuggled across the border, as so we have serious concerns. We did a joint letter in November that Chief Nishandarapa and myself were part of with other chiefs, police chiefs and mayors. And, you know, if this does come back, I would like to see it amended in a fashion that we state the request before we endorse their plan, just if we could state the request of the Peel Police that we take smuggling seriously. If this is going to be deferred, then I don't need to add that amendment in now, but I would hope that if it is not going to be deferred, then I would suggest that we add the request of the Peel Police to whatever motion we pass today. Obviously, they're on the front lines for us dealing with gun and gang crime, and we should be consistent with what they've recognized as a serious gun issue we have in Peel and how it's linked to the border.
So thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I respect your comments, and I think that I think I'm going to put the deferral on based on those comments and some of the other actions and information that need to come back for this council's endorsement. I look forward to supporting this motion once we have more of that information, but I will hold that deferral because I do see members on the board.
Councillor Pelleschi, you can't speak and then move the deferral, the clerk just told me. So it would have to be the next speaker before they speak, they would have to move the deferral. So otherwise,
then you can refer it.
A referral is fine.
Yeah, refer back to staff for the information that's been requested. Okay. But I'll hold that referral because members may want to talk about the motion in its entirety.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi. I just say, I think everyone is on the same page when it comes to wanting better gun control. And the incident that happened in Nova Scotia was heart-wrenching, heartbreaking. And so, to Councillor Williams, of course, we all share your sentiments that one of the things I love about Canada is that it isn't a gun culture, and we need to continue to make sure that this is that type of environment where we don't need to worry about our kids or loved ones being at risk to weapons being used inappropriately. And so I think the sentiment is in the right place, but let's just see if we can get this exactly right. Councillor Santos.
thank you through you, Mayor, to the councillor putting the motion forward. Have you spoken to the Chief of Police about this motion and their stance on this particular program?
I have, and sorry, I'm getting an echo. I have spoken to the Chief of Police, and you know, where they're at right now is they are prohibited, and so the next step is to make sure that they have all of the resources and tools to be able to effectively run a gun buyback program. And so, you know, the message that they're hearing too is people want to make sure that they're fairly compensated. So this motion is speaking to ensuring that residents who have firearms in the region of Peel are being fairly compensated, and that we are supporting this positive move that the federal government is doing to take that step, and it's a bold step. And I think as a council, it's great for us to endorse that, and it sends a message to all of those who've been impacted by gun violence that we are on the side of ensuring that they are feeling safe in our city.
So thank you, Councillor, for clarifying that. And I don't think there's any one councillor or mayor or staff person in the city of Brampton who would disagree with wanting to make sure that Brampton is safe and free from gun violence in Brampton. So, but I do agree with Councillor Pelleschi in terms of some of the more details, the details that we actually need in understanding how much it's going to be and who's going to fund it and who's responsible for bringing it back. So some of those details, I think we do need to get. And I think that the referral should appropriately be referred to Peel Regional Police for a more thorough look. At the end of the day, they are the ones who have the data. They are going to be the ones who are going to have to enforce it. It's not going to be the city of Brampton. And they are the ones who are going to be able to get answers probably more quickly than we would be able to from the federal government. So I support the referral, and more specifically would refer it to Peel Regional Police.
So through you, Mr. Mayor. Procedurally, the Peel Regional Police is another jurisdiction. A referral motion is referring to staff. It could be a request of Peel Regional Police, but it doesn't compel Peel Regional Police or an external agency to report back. So I just want council to be aware. So it could be passed on as information, but a council can't refer something to an outside body and expect a response back, because it may not come.
Fair
Mr.
enough.
Mr. Mayor, if I can.
So I'd happily refer it to staff and request that it be sent to police for a response, and maybe Mayor Brown can bring that to the board table.
Councilor Medeiros.
Thank you, Mayor. Just to speak to, and I appreciate the points that have been led by some of my colleagues who want to refer this. And I do want to say I thank Councillor Williams for bringing this forward, and I was happy to second it. Just to give some backup, I had the opportunity to attend during the campaign last federal election, where the leader of the Liberal Party and some of their proposals for gun measures were criticized for not going far enough, were criticized for having during different violent crimes that's happened and shootings, and was accused of not having more teeth and including more, you know, stronger or I guess more powerful weapons in the complete gun ban. Then, as a result of what happened in Nova Scotia, we have a government who's now made an announcement, and I think what this motion does is just encouraging the government to implement measures that keep tackling and removing guns off our streets. Now, is this motion essentially, you know, with the details and plans, which I'm hearing from my colleagues saying that they want to bring forward and they want to recede to, I don't know how that would impact your decision to support ultimately getting guns off the street, if we inch towards getting the issue. And then after the other thing I would like to stress, and I appreciate that members of council want to go to Peel Regional Police on many issues. We discussed an issue last term of council, which was very problematic regarding carding. And Peel forces and many of the police forces had one opinion, And but we knew that carding was such a controversial issue, and it was being targeted certain minority groups, and was being targeted in a way which wasn't supported by society in general. There were changes to the whole carding. So sometimes I think we have to take it tactfully. We go to our police force and we do get our guidance, but politically sometimes there has to be the understanding that we make decisions that sort of balance society, and again, they are the experts when it comes to this field. But when we're talking about an opportunity to signal to the government, yes, continue to take guns off the streets, continue to look at all assets of guns. If you want to improve the motion and bring it forward, effectively, what are we saying here today? That the municipality, similar to, as far as I know, we approved motions such as supporting democracy in Guyana. I would challenge every councillor on this council, many, to speak to me about how they feel that democracy in Guyana is being impacted. But we heard residents speak, and we gathered together, and without full details, we supported it. I've seen many emotions, so for us to go back and have staff go back on their time to come back with the detail to essentially say what we're saying today, get guns, any type of measure that you're bringing in to introduce and remove guns, is a good measure. And the fact that government continues to look at, you have the input as a private citizen, as a representative, to send your thoughts to your federal government on the gun back problem, but I wouldn't want to second it. I think we're just sending staff to go off and take off their time. I think the motion speaks for itself. We're supporting essentially a government initiative and a government announcement after a very difficult situation that happened in Nova Scotia. And this always reminds me of whenever these situations happen, we sit back, and many politicians sit back and sit there, well, let's consider all the details, let's get back. And no, effectively what we're saying is we want action, and the government, we're encouraging the government to continue to action. And I think similar to what we've done in other areas, we're formalizing and recognition of the federal government that they're doing what they're doing and that we support it. So for us to sit back and wait for, I don't know what other further details that's going to sway your position, I just think that wouldn't be opportune. I would encourage everyone not to support the deferral and come back and support this motion. Essentially what effectively says is, yes, federal government, we as a municipality encourage you. And that's what I heard when I met with our current Premier Trudeau. And it was all big city mayors from the GTA mayors. Effectively, that was everything that was said, that they wanted more teeth and they wanted to see more guns on the list. And effectively, that's what they're looking at. So I'm not sure, again, at this stage to deferring it, what we're deferring it to and what we expect in details, information that we're going to get back to. So I thank Councillor Williams, and that's it. Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Medeiros. We have this. We had the referral now. Does anyone want to speak to the referral? I've got Councillor Frattini, Pelleschi, Williams, and Bowman all wanting to speak. I assume you all want to speak to the referral. Okay, Councillor Frattini.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you, everyone. I guess nobody wants guns in their city, but you know, I always thought we needed 2/3 to reopen this, as we talked about in the past. You know, when we talk about guns, I always agree, it's mostly the guns are smuggled over the border. That's the main issue. My question is, just when we talk about selling a gun, you know, it's like selling a car. Like, if you buy a gun that's registered to you, you can't just go ahead and sell a gun to anyone on the street. So, unless if the gun is stolen, which is reported. So, you know, as I say, I find that going back, I hear that, you know, this is coming.
Councillor Frattini, we're speaking to the referral. Yeah, if the referral is unsuccessful, then we can speak to the main motion. And I've said the things you mentioned about smuggling, I will certainly add that amendment on if the referral doesn't work. But right now, we're just debating whether we refer this for additional information.
Well, I like to agree with Councillor Pelleschi, because this report's coming back in October, speaking to the referral. Okay. We don't know exactly what they're bringing forward. So we're kind of supporting something what's not in front of us. So, like, I like to see what the federal government's doing. What happens if we don't like what they're saying at the end? I know they're talking about 1,500 type of guns, so I like to wait for them. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Pelleschi.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And just to be a little bit more factual here, from what I've been told, that the plan is already out there. So staff having to do any work on this is sounds to me like it should be a phone call to get some of that information back to us. I think when we're talking about the ban on assault-style firearms, I don't think there's any question with respect to that. The federal government has made that decision, and we in turn want to get more guns off of the street. But when we're talking about the gun buyback program and not having that information before us, essentially what we could be looking at is the federal government announcing something that isn't going to work. The bottom line is, and since we're talking about, you know, Guyana and stuff, if I own a fishing rod and that fishing rod costs some $200+ and the federal government bans that style of fishing rod and only wants to give me $25 for it, that fishing rod is not going back to the federal government. And I think that's what it comes down to, is what is actually going to get guns off the street and what is actually going to get guns off of the street. That's what we're talking about. And I can't support something that may not work in the long term. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, Councillor Williams.
Hi, thank you. You know, in speaking to the referral, you know, gun owners should be compensated, and this motion is to send that message. They should be compensated. We're on the anniversary, approaching anniversary of a shooting that happened in Brampton. And so to defer or refer right now, I think it's just not the message we want to send. We are taking a bold step in supporting the federal government. We want to congratulate them for doing this. This is extremely groundbreaking right now in Canada. And so to move it, to defer and refer and trying to get more information from staff, I think is not the step that we should be taking right now. We are going to have to engage in conversations with levels of government, and support the Peel Regional Police. That's going to happen anyway. So I would like to just see the motion, go forward as originally read, and just leave it with that and send a message to our residents that we want to see you compensated and we appreciate this bold move that the federal government is making to help make our streets safer. Thank you.
Councillor Bowman.
Thank you very much through you, Mr. Mayor. I want to get clarification on what we're doing here. We're being asked to refer this back to staff, but as far as I see, the original motion, without any of the amendments, simply says that we endorse the recently announced proposed national gun buyback program. It's a proposal by the federal government. If we don't endorse it, that doesn't mean it's not going to happen. And if we do endorse it, it doesn't mean it's not going to happen. And no matter if we endorse it or not, our police forces are going to have to deal with whatever the federal government puts into effect and turns into law. So I don't see the referral as having a lot of bearing on our decision to support a proposal at the federal government level. So I'd just like clarification on that from Peter, if I could, that we're supporting what they've already announced as a proposal. They've not announced any real numbers. They haven't come out with dollar figures. We're just supporting what they're proposing at this moment, correct?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, the operative paragraph of the original motion is to endorse a federal government program. That's it.
Okay, so the line, therefore, be it resolved, endorse the proposed national gun buyback program is not in there anymore?
If I may, it is there. It is the recently announced proposed national gun buyback program and assault style firearms ban.
So it's confusing to me as to which we're supporting, a program or the proposal of a program.
It's the proposed national gun buyback program and the ban. It's just the program and the ban. And we are, it's supporting in principle, because you're right, there are no numbers that have been decided as of date.
Okay, that was my only question. I just want to make sure that I'm clear on both the proposal and the referral, what they're asking for. So, and Peter, where in this motion does it talk about the program?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, if you can see on the screen, at the top it says, therefore be it resolved that City Council endorse the recently announced proposed national gun buyback program and assault style firearms ban. That is the net effect of this motion, is to endorse a federally announced program and buyback program. The motions that are shown in red are proposed amendments identified by the mover, and if they're not accepted as friendly amendments, they can be properly moved as amendments, but they will require a seconder. Currently, what is on the floor right now, Mr. Mayor, to members of council, is a referral motion from Councillor Santos.
So, if I may, I'm not going to accept those amendments as friendlies, and I would like to move the motion as is, and if we want to add those amendments and vote on them afterwards, I think that would be great. Thanks.
Okay, Mr. Mayor,
so we have the referral motion on the floor right now.
Okay. Can I speak to the referral? It's Councillor Santos. Can I speak to the referral, please?
Is Councillor Bowman, are you finished?
No. I want to ask one more question. For the referral, are we referring it simply until we hear numbers and dollar values from the provincial government?
Provincial, meaning the federal government, yes.
Yeah. Is that when we're referring this to?
Yes.
That was the idea when I moved the referral, yes.
Okay, but then we have these other motions, refer back, provision appeal, regional police service, and for consideration. What the original referral is, Councillor Pelleschi, is it simply to get the numbers from the federal government on what they're proposing?
Yes, thank you, Councillor Bowman. When I moved the referral, it was talking about more the amounts in the buyback program. I have no problem if we like to separate the council's endorsement of the assault style firearms ban. If you'd like to vote on that separately, I'm happy to. I would like to ask for it to be separated. And it's just my comments on when I moved the referral was for the proposed national gun buyback program.
Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Pelleschi, the clerk tells me he has the referral from Councillor Santos, but he said you contemplated it but didn't.
He said he held it down.
You held it down, he says.
Oh, right. I held it back. And typically, members of council tend to do that to allow other members of council not to be restricted by speaking to the referral. So let's not, you know, pick and choose what we do at council meetings, please.
Okay.
I realized procedurally, Peter, but I made it very clear that I was going to stand it down, and we've done that prior in a lot of other council meetings.
Councillor Santos, can we make this referral motion from both you and Councillor Pelleschi?
I'm comfortable with the referral motion coming from Councillor Pelleschi, because I've listened to the debate in the meantime and am happy to vote on the motion as it stands today and just keep moving.
Does anyone else want to speak to the referral before we vote on the referral? And it's been separated.
Let me just make one comment, Mr. Mayor.
Can I, point of order, if we are going to vote on the motion as it stands, should we not do that first? And then the following motions to refer the item to staff, wouldn't that come afterwards?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. In the order of precedence, a procedural motion of a referral takes precedent. So that will be the first motion the council will vote on. It will be a referral of the original motion as well as the proposed amendments. All of it would be referred to staff as set out in the referral motion. If that carries, the matter is dealt with. If that does not carry, then the main motion has still been moved, and there are two amendments shown in red. Those amendments would be taken first in order in which they were introduced. They do not appear to be contrary, and they are properly placed motions. They would just require a seconder.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to speak.
Okay, Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you. So, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to refer the separate the National Gun Buyback Program and the with the assault style firearms ban. And I can see that maybe some members of council are wavering a little bit here. And I think it's just important to recognize the fact that. So the facts are the majority of guns come over the border. They're not sold illegally by registered gun owners. You have to register a gun in this country to legally own a firearm. So I think it's important to recognize the fact that the majority of the guns that come over that are killing people, and it's not guns that kill people, it's people that kill people, are coming over the border. And I think that it's important that we always, and I know all members of council support and agree that we continue to ask our federal government to increase the opportunity to stop guns from coming over the border. But I also think it's important that if we, and I mean levels of government, are going to do something, we make sure that we do it right. I don't know if any member of council would say that our other levels of government or any government has always done things right. Sometimes people make mistakes. And if they're going to administer a gun buyback program, I would love to support it, but I can't support it if they're not going to be realistic about it and actually have people that are coming out and that they're going to be handing in their guns. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Okay, so now we have the vote on the referral. Moved by Councillor Pelleschi and Santos. And so are we going to vote to the clerk
Through you, Mr. Mayor, this would be a vote on the motion that's on the screen for referral only at this point in time.
Okay.
Is that a recorded vote?
Okay, recorded vote on the referral.
So a recorded vote has been requested on the referral motion as highlighted on the screen. All in favor of referral, Councillor Santos?
Point of order, it just says moved by Councillor Santos. It should be moved by Councillor Pelleschi. And my vote is no to the referral.
Thank you.
So you're saying no to your own motion, Councillor Santos?
It's Councillor Pelleschi's motion now.
Okay.
It's Councillor Pelleschi's motion.
Councillor Vasante, how do you vote?
I am also no for referral.
Councillor Willens?
And no for referral.
Councillor Pelleschi?
Yes.
Councillor Bowman?
No.
Councillor Medeiros?
No.
Councillor Williams?
No.
Councillor Fortini?
No.
Councillor Singh?
No.
Councillor Dillon?
No.
Mayor Brown?
And no.
So, Mr. Mayor, the referral motion does not carry. The vote is 1-10.
Okay, now the motion?
So, through you, Mr. Mayor, now the motions would be the two motions in red. The first one moved by Councillor Santos, it will require a seconder because it is an amendment to the main motion.
Happy to second.
I believe that was Councillor Vasante. So it is highlighted in yellow on the screen. So I believe there was a recorded vote for each of the amendments as well. So all in favor of the amendment shown as yellow on the screen, moved by Councillor Santos, seconded by Councillor Vasante. Councillor Santos.
Yes.
Councillor Vasante.
Yes.
Councillor Willens.
Hang on a second. Yes.
Thank you. Councillor Pelleschi.
Yes.
Councillor Bowman.
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Williams?
Yes.
Councillor Fortini?
Yes.
Councillor Singh?
Yes.
Councillor Dillon?
Yes.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor, that amendment from Councillor Santos carries 11-0. The next amendment is the second one in red, moved by Mayor Brown, and it will require a seconder.
So this is consistent with the first motion. So I think the first one encapsulates this, so I don't think this is necessary.
You're going to withdraw the motion?
Withdraw it, yeah.
Okay. The second one is withdrawn. The final vote, members of council, will be the original motion as amended. Recorded vote's been requested. Councillor Santos?
So Mr. Mayor, I have a question on the original motion.
Okay.
So I'd like to separate the National Gun Buyback Program with the assault style ban. I'd like to separate the two.
So for simplicity, members of council, we will treat the National Gun Buyback Program as part A, and we will treat the assault style firearms ban as part B. So the first vote will be on the motion, on the notice of motion as amended on part A only, as it relates to the gun buyback program. All in favor, Councillor Santos?
Yes.
Councillor Vasante?
Yes, thank you.
Councillor Willens?
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi?
No.
Councillor Bowman?
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Williams?
Yes.
Councillor Fortini?
Yes.
Councillor Singh?
Yes.
Councillor Dillon?
Yes.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
Yes. That motion carries part A 10-1. The next recorded vote and final recorded vote on this item is on part B, which is the ban on assault style firearms. Councillor Santos?
Yes.
Councillor Vasante?
Yes.
Councillor Willens?
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi?
Yes.
Councillor Bowman?
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Williams?
Yes.
Councillor Fortini?
Yes.
Councillor Singh?
Yes.
Councillor Dillon?
Yes.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
That carries, Mr. Mayor, 11-0. And that concludes the voting on that item.
Okay. Our next item, 16.2, moved by Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Medeiros, in regards to the commemoration for the 45th anniversary of the mass shooting of Brampton Centennial Secondary School. Councillor Williams, you have the floor.
Thank you. So 45 years ago, the unthinkable happened in Brampton. A student took the life of two other students, himself and injured 13 others. This tragic event happened at Brampton Centennial Secondary School and has shaken the city, and the memories of that event are still fresh for many still living in Brampton. The shooting at BCSS marked the first time in Canadian history that anyone had been killed in a mass shooting, school shooting in Canada. And like the healing process still continues for many. The anniversary of that date is approaching, and many have shared that declaring May 28th as a day of healing and remembrance would be a good step to allow for many impacted to never let those lost be forgotten, and to remind us all of how precious life is. My office has connected with the local trustees and the school board and our protocol office to collaborate and explore ways to have a virtual ceremony to remember the tragic event. So I have a motion seconded by Councillor Medeiros, and it reads as follows. Whereas May 28th, 2020 marks the 45th anniversary of the mass shooting in Brampton Centennial Secondary School, and whereas the mass shooting of 15 people at the hands of a fellow student at Brampton Centennial School has scarred the lives of the surviving victims and their families, and whereas May 28th, 1975 marked the first time in Canadian history that anyone had been killed in a mass school shooting in Canada, and whereas the healing process for many still continues, And whereas the community banded together in 2017 to install a memorial called the Healing Place that is located on the grounds of Brampton Centennial Secondary School. Therefore, be it resolved that the Brampton City Council proclaim May 28, 2020 as a day of healing in recognition of the solemn day of remembrance of a tragic event that, or day, sorry, that occurred in our community. Thank you.
Councillor Willens.
Yeah, thank you for bringing this forward. I'm not opposed to the motion. I just wish that the two movers had have consulted with council members prior to this, one being Councillor for, Bowman and myself. We started this in April 26th in 2016. Pam Hand came to us at the time. She was one of the students that was at the school. I don't think anybody on council, or perhaps some of the people in Brampton, have lived through this more than I have. My father was a teacher at that school. He helped load students into the ambulances. So I just would appreciate a little bit heads up on this. I know it was in there, but maybe a little discussion. I'm not opposing it by any means, but I do think we should have reached out to the community as well. Councillor Bowman is probably going to comment on this as well, because we did have some resistance, because I had a friend that was shot, actually, unfortunately didn't die, and I had another friend that was narrowly missed by a bullet, and they were somewhat opposed when we brought this monument forward back then, a number of years ago. But I think it is commemorable what we're doing here. There should be a day of mourning for the. It did affect the city very, very much so. We did a lot of work to get that monument there, and it was John Spoveri, former councillor, that actually came up with the money from one of his contacts to get that monument built. It wasn't without struggle. We tried going through community grant program, and we did have a lot of opposition from council of the day back then. So just keeping that in mind, but thank you both for bringing this back up. It is important to the community, and I just wanted to get that off my chest and let everybody know. So thank you.
Councilor Medeiros is next.
Thank you, Mayor, and I wish I would have got on before Councilor Willens, because I would have had expressed that Councilor Bowman should second this along with myself, and certainly at the time, I could tell you, Councilor Williams, and when this was raised, there was a chat and there was recognition of the great work involved with councillors from previous council, specifically as you referenced, and it would be more appropriate if Councillor Bowman, who, if I'm not mistaken, did attend the school as well, and he'll speak to it. But that's essentially what I want to say, that I do agree with the motion, and I do recognize the important work that other councillors did on this. And living right next to this school, I know how I pass by this monument every day on my daily walks, and every day, you know, it does come as a passing thought of what that is, and people still, you know, ask and still wonder what that that memorial is, and certainly I know there are many other councillors who were very instrumental in that. So thank you for pointing that out, and I would ask that you put Councillor Bowman and more than welcome any other councillors, Councillor Williams as well, as seconding the motion as well. I'd put that forward. Thank you.
Thank you. If I may, I absolutely would love to have Councillor Bowman. I know Councillor Bowman and I had spoken about this motion, and also Pam Hand, we have been in contact with her as well. And, you know, it was a tragic event, and Councillor Williams, your father did play such an important role and an admirable and courageous role in the event. And absolutely, I would, you know, love to have you all second the motion as well, and you know, look at ways that we can ensure that everyone has a voice, and so everyone should be included in coming up with a strategy to have a virtual day of healing for this May 28th.
Councillor Bowman.
Thank you very much through you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you to the other speakers. I don't think there is anyone who would disagree that the shooting at Centennial was a changing point in the history of the city. You know, people say Brampton grew up that day, so to speak, from a little small town that it was. My only concern when I spoke with Councillor Williams about this was that when Councillor Willens and I and Sprovieri were meeting about putting up the monument there, the monument was actually put there for Centennial High School's 50th anniversary, but because it was such a big part of the school, it was included there. There was resistance. There was resistance on the part of the school board. There was resistance on the part of some of the people, some of the families of the victims, some of the people who were at the school when the shooting happened that day. I did go to Centennial High School for my length of time from grade 9 to 13. But, you know, I just hope that, you know, we can all support this. But I just hope we're not getting into something like we've done before, changing the name of a street, things like that without the proper consultation. I hate to think that we're going to be doing this and celebrating a recognized day and putting a proclamation forward, and there is going to be people out there who are very, very, very hurt by the thought of this being brought up again. And I don't know how we include those people, and I don't know how we reach out to those people before we actually make this proclamation. I think we have to be very aware of everybody's feelings, and a lot of those people who were at the school, a lot of those people you know, who worried about brothers or sisters or parents who were at the school are still in this city. And I want to be sure that there's not going to be people who really, really don't want us to bring this back up again on its anniversary. So I support having a day. I support having a day of recognition and remembrance. But I think it goes beyond that. And I think we need to have feelings for some people who may not want this brought up, or it may be traumatic to bring this up. And I just don't know how we go about including those voices in this proclamation. Thanks.
Councillor Willens.
Yeah, thank you through you, Mr. Mayor. I tend to agree with Jeff. I'm just trying to I totally support that we should recognize May 28th, absolutely. It's kind of ironic. I met my wife because her family wouldn't move near to Centennial because they moved to Brampton. I think it was about 6 months after that shooting, so she ended up going to the high school that I attended. So something good did come out of this, I suppose, if that's what you could say. But I'm wondering if we could just recognize this, proclaim it as a day of healing, and maybe just limit the if there's some way, I know Pam Hand's been very involved, maybe there's some way we could do the virtual remembrance for those that want it. Because I agree with Jeff, there was some very, there's a lot of people scarred by this in the community. I was pulled out of high school not knowing if my father was alive or dead. So, but yeah, maybe we can do it without having the virtual, or without maybe doing a virtual meeting with those that want to. We certainly know a lot of people that did support the monument going in, and there was a lot of people that did show up and hugged and reminisced. So maybe there's some way we can do it and not do it so it's not a public, so people can sort of take part if they want to. Because I agree, there is still a lot of people that are scarred by it. So, but I'll leave that up to the movers of the motion, and I'm okay not having my name on, but I'm glad that Jeff's on there as well. He did attend the school, and he is the area councillor. But thank you both for bringing this forward.
Thank you.
It's actually Councillor Pelleschi next.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So just a question then,
from what I recall in the discussion last term, and what I'm hearing from members of council, so there may be people that have issues with us doing this. Is that correct?
Jeff, do you want to speak on that?
Yeah, sure. Councillor Pelleschi, it's not the fact that they would have issues with us doing it. It's the fact that it may stir up a lot of feelings that either have not been dealt with or repressed or been taken care of since that day it actually happened. And I just want to make sure that somehow we have spoken to some of those people or we're taking their feelings into consideration by doing this motion. And I fully support doing this, but I just want to make sure everybody's included in it.
So I guess typically, I think when we recognize a day due to a tragedy, it typically comes from a community or a group. Or was this at all in factored into, or was there any kind of outreach? That question is to the mover and the seconder of the motion.
Yes, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi. Yes, there was conversations with the community as we approached the day. I think the shooting that happened in Nova Scotia really, unearthed a lot of feelings and, brought back a lot of memories. And especially as we approach May 28th, there has been conversation. So, we reached out to the community to ask, would something like this be helpful? I think back in 1975, the grief therapy and counseling and trauma therapy, post-traumatic stress therapy was not widely used as a way to heal. And, over time, people are looking to have days of remembrance to mourn together, be together. And so that's why we also reached out to the protocol office to, let's look at ways that we can have a day. And because of COVID-19, we can't encourage people to go to the memorial site, which people have done in the past, leave flowers or just been there to gather. So, having an alternative to allow people to have that opportunity to be with those who want to remember in this way is allowing for that opportunity to happen.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. And just the question was around the outreach, and you have outreach to the community. Thank you.
Yes, thanks.
Councillor Fortini.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm calling the question.
I don't think there's any other speakers, so that's perfect timing.
Yeah, I would like a recorded vote, please.
Recorded vote.
Recorded vote's been requested on notice of motion 16.2. All in favor, please indicate. Councillor Santos.
Yes.
Councillor Vasante.
Yes, thank you.
Councillor Willens.
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Yes.
Councillor Bowman.
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros.
Yes.
Councillor Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Fortini.
Yes.
Councillor Singh.
Yes.
Councillor Dillon.
Yes.
Mayor Brown.
Yes.
That motion carries unanimously 11-0.
Okay. That takes us to the next item, which is there's no petitions. There's no any other business?
There is lots of other okay. Business after referred matters.
After referred matters. Okay, so do referred matters first. Are there any referred matters?
There's no question.
Any questions for the referred matters? Seeing none. That takes 18.2. Added by Councillor Santos in regards to the National Urban Cycling Fund. There was a letter distributed at the start of the meeting when the item was added from Jeff Binks, lead advocate, Red Mile Complete Street Advocacy Group, in regards to the national urban cycling strategy of the COVID-19 economic stimulus. Councillor Santos, if you'd like to speak to this.
Yeah, just very quickly. So I got correspondence from an advocate in Calgary who is working to advocate to the federal government during their economic stimulus infrastructure spending and plans. to allocate some funds for that economic stimulus infrastructure funding towards active transportation. It's really good timing. The City of Brampton, we have been taking a very lead role on the active transportation file in response to COVID-19. And sadly, on May the 2nd, we had a cyclist killed in Brampton in a hit and run situation. And so I think that the City of Brampton, we should continue to be taking the lead on this file and support movement going forward as the federal government contemplates and prioritizes infrastructure spending to stimulate the economy. And so the motion is before you. I also sent it to various councillors ahead of time. It's essentially, therefore, be it resolved, the mayor write a letter to the federal government supporting the creation of a national urban cycling infrastructure fund of at least $265 million as part of a COVID-19 economic stimulus package to be distributed over the next 2 years to Canadian cities. B, the city support the federal government's recent announcement to establish a national active transportation strategy and advocate for the longer term sustainable funding to implement active transportation infrastructure and programs. C, the City of Brampton bring forward this matter for discussion at the forthcoming conferences of AMO and FCM, and that this letter be shared with the region of Peel and neighboring GTHA municipalities as an encouragement towards a collaborative advocacy to the federal government for a national urban cycling infrastructure stimulus fund. I will also add that this particular issue and advocating for this plan also supports our objectives as we support Vision 2040 Brampton, as well as the declaration we made about a climate emergency. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Santos. Let me just add, this is a bit of a no-brainer. All municipalities are just asking the federal government to chip in on urban transit infrastructure. Mayor Nenshi in Calgary is taking a lead and some of his councillors, and I'm glad that we're adding our names to that advocacy. So thank you, Councillor Santos, for looking all the way to Calgary for a good idea. And just like they supported of us on our motion on religious freedom, I think this makes sense. It's a good idea. And that given the fact we are doing this right now, we're looking at our urban transit infrastructure, I think it's appropriate that we join this call. Councillor Bowman, you had a question?
Not really a question, just I'm wondering if I can make a friendly amendment there, that we also include, when we bring it back, the cycling committee has done a tremendous amount of work since its inception, I guess 5 years ago, and I think they would want to also be key on this as one of the objectives that they've raised for 5 years. So if somehow we could just add in our own cycling committee, and I believe Councillor Santos is on that, if I'm not mistaken.
That's correct, Councillor Bowman, and you'll be pleased to know that this was also forwarded to the members of the Cyclist Advisory Committee, specifically Dale Lang, David Lang, Kevin Montgomery, and Lisa Stokes, and they are supportive of this motion.
Okay, yeah, no, I just wondered if it's apropos to include them as backing for the motion at the Fed level. That's all.
Okay, thank you. The motion's on the floor, moved by Councillor Santos, seconded by myself. Are there any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries, and we now move on to item 18.3, which Charlotte will put on.
Yep, sorry, Mr. Mayor, just before we leave this item, there's at the bottom on the screen in red is just the receipt of the correspondence from Calgary, so if we can vote on that as well.
Can I also get a motion moved by, do we have movers already? Moved by Councillor Santos and Councillor Vicente to receive the correspondence. Any objections? None, the motion carries.
So, Mr. Mayor, the next item is 18.3, the added item from Councillor Pelleschi regarding the CIP.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just with respect to the CIP program, we've had some conversations around the program. There's been some questions that have come up, length of time,
and having this program across the city, excellent program, but some of the questions on just related to how this is going to what this looks like in how it's going to affect Brampton. I'm requesting that staff start working on the possibility of a virtual workshop. I don't think we've done a workshop as of yet on virtually, and I think that this is this would be a perfect time to have that. I know that staff's on the line if they want to include anything, and Councillor Vicente may want to include something as well. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you.
Mayor Brown and members of committee, it's Richard.
Yes, Richard.
So, Mayor Brown and members of committee, that's a great question. As council may recall, the citywide CIP started last year under a different social and economic environment than exists today. The good part of so we've been doing a lot of work. Staff have been doing a lot of great work on two focus areas: affordable housing and economic revitalization. Now, what we had planned to do is a council workshop before the end of June to touch base with council. And I think, given the current economic recovery environment, that there's opportunity to bake into the CIP, citywide CIP, as we move forward. So it's a great opportunity to host a virtual workshop. We're looking forward to doing that. We've been doing, as Councillor Plessy may know, we've been doing some virtual workshops with the Heritage Heights folks as we move that project forward. So this is a critical piece, I think, as far as a component of the economic recovery. And so it is good timing to do that.
And Mr. Mayor, if I just might add to that, and that we request the region come and be a part of that workshop as well, to talk a little bit about that program that they have at the region, and how both programs essentially could benefit Brampton. And I think this is a great news story. I think this is going to be a great workshop to set us in the right direction. I look forward to it. Thank you.
Okay. See no other questions? We need a motion or no? Okay, that takes us to item 18.4, Councillor Fertini, regards to swimming pools.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. So this past weekend, I was over a friend's, and they were building a pool next door. And I looked at the way the electrical was done, no junction box, no GFC switch. And I find, I asked how these guys get a permit. And I find out we're the only municipality that don't need permits for pools. So I'm asking staff maybe to look into this, because now, you know, people are building these pools, you know, and with no permits. We do need a permit for a fence. I know there's a law, you need a 4-foot fence around the pool for safety, but the way they're being built, we're the only municipality that you do not need a permit to build a pool. But you need a permit if you want to backfill to make sure that the liner and the walls are down so the water doesn't sit in there. So I'm asking staff, maybe we should look into this and do it, charge a permit, not expensive, even $50, but at least it gets inspected and it's done right.
Okay, Richard, are you able to answer that? Is that in terms of Councillor Fertini's concern?
Well, Mayor Brown and members of the committee certainly will look into that. I know that we like to have the Electrical Safety Authority be the primary approval body for anything related to electrical, because quite frankly, we're not that's not in our bailiwick. But however, I'll ask our chief billing official to certainly respond to that, and we'll provide an email to members of council.
So I guess on that note, Richard or Paul Morrison, if you can answer, is there no permit required to build a pool in Brampton? And right now, even during the pandemic, someone could be building a pool?
To you, Mr. Mayor, it's Paul Morrison. The permit is for a pool fence. And my understanding, it's when they issue it, it's inclusive of the understanding a pool will be built and the fence will be built around it. It's an old term. It should be updated. And there should be a couple of more maybe some more considerations put into it. It's a difficult one in the sense that you're getting the permits for the fence, but with the understanding of pool is there. So maybe it needs to be brought up to the 2020 time period.
Okay.
And we do, in this case, I can add that permits were issued prior to April 4th for pool fences, and there was a discussion about that, whether that included building the pool, and that's where this stemmed from. And right now, my understanding is if you have a pool fence permit, that you can build the pool.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with Commissioner Richard there about the electrical. We have no jurisdiction, but don't forget we have also gas. And when you start hooking up the gas heaters, you know, that's how fires start, when people don't know what they're doing, and the electrical right beside the gas. So I'm asking staff, look into it. We're the only municipality. So you get a permit for a fence, and then you go ahead and build a pool. So the fence is very easy to get a permit, but, you know, the permit is you buy fences, they come 4 feet tall, so it's very easy to install, but nobody inspects the pool if it's done right or wrong. And someone builds it, sells their home, and then whoever takes over, they could have the issue. So, thank you.
Okay, Councillor Singh?
Yeah, I just want to, I've had similar concerns regarding pool issues. I don't want to just put a motion on right now because we're in the middle of COVID, but I would be more than open for a review of the bylaw maybe near the end of the year or whatnot, and yeah, because I do think we have to look at it. So I'm not going to put a motion, but something that staff can consider.
Okay. There's no motion on the floor. Okay, Councillor, did we get to Councillor Bowman's question? That's a previous one.
I think it was a previous
Okay, so there's no motion. That takes us to item 18.5 has already been dealt with. This takes us to 18.6. Councillor Dillon on the airport taxi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I have a motion that I'm putting forward. I've had conversations with the airport taxi association. Councillor Fattini and I have, and as many of you may know, that since the pandemic has started, that a disproportionate amount of taxi and limo drivers have died due to COVID-19, and their asks are pretty simple. And so my motion is just our motion, Councillor Fattini and I, is simply just asking Council to support their request to the Ministry and to the GTAA for stricter screening measures for all passengers landing at airport, and that the GTA provide personal and protective equipment and training, and that their fees be waived. And you know, they've also expressed a concern that they're not being made aware of some of these pre-existing medical conditions. A recent study in the UK found that taxi and limo drivers are among the most likely to die from the virus. And so we all know that the industry has been classified as essential by the province. All five registered taxi companies and two limo companies at Pearson are operating despite the COVID-19 health risks and the plummeting revenues. And considering that they're frontline workers doing the great service of getting passengers to where they need to go, and GTAA personnel to getting them where they need to go, you know, they've asked for the support of Brampton City Council, as I wouldn't go as far as saying a majority, but a great amount of these drivers are from the city of Brampton. And so the motion is on the floor, and if you want, I could read through the whereas is. Would you like me to do that, Mr. Mayor, or would you like me to just
I think everyone's able to see it on the screen. The one thing I'd ask, Councillor Dillon, is it possible to add one more line at the end, asking the mayor to write a letter as well, to the Minister of Transportation and to the GTA? I'm on a liaison committee, but I think if I'm directed to do this on behalf of council, it would add, it would make the letter even more persuasive.
Yeah, that'd be great, actually.
And ultimately, it is the GTA's decision, but I think if we also write the Minister of Transportation, because federal airports are, all airports are under federal authority, that it will raise the pressure to them as well.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. I just want to add some of the financial hardships, Mr. Mayor, that they've been facing. And the industry has been decimated, and, you know, 95% or 96% of flights are currently canceled and grounded. And so it's a real tough time for them right now. And so whether it's safety or whether it's any type of relief that they get, you know, they've indicated that it would be appreciative, and you know, they're really looking forward to our council supporting them.
Councillor Bowman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Just want to clarify with Councillor Dillon, is he suggesting that the GTAA, the airport, provide them with PPE equipment, each of the cab drivers and the limo drivers?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, this is the request that they have made to the GTA, that the Airport Taxi Association has made.
Okay, and sorry?
Yeah, please go ahead, Councillor Bowman.
Okay, and the second part, the elimination of the monthly fee, what has the federal government and the provincial government already put in place for taxi drivers? We did talk about this briefly when we were talking about the local cab drivers, and there is federal and provincial programs that they are also open and available for, is there not?
So right now there's the, I believe it's the CERB that is available, but for many of these drivers that's not enough to get by, and so they're forced to work right now, and also the provincial government classified them as essential, and so that's why they are working. Obviously some have decided not to, chose not to, but there's many that have, and so this is just a letter of support in terms of what their requests are. Obviously you know, it's a discussion that the Taxi Association will have, and you know, being at the front line, I know the mayor and Councillor Singh can speak to some of our trucking industry as well, who face some issues and get not being able to access washrooms. And we were able to have a conversation with some of these companies, such as CN Rail, who were, you know, they, you know, after discussion, they were able to open their washrooms up. And so this is just giving us a helping hand, giving them a helping hand, and showing support at the same time.
Okay, yeah, I really have no issue with the motion, Councillor Dillon, but I'm not certain about the PPE equipment being given, but that's fine. We're just endorsing the fact that they're going to ask for it, so I'm fine with it. Thank you.
No, I appreciate that.
Councillor Vasante.
Thank you, through you, Mayor. I also had concerns along the lines of Councillor Bowman with respect to the providing of personal protective equipment, In employment law, Occupational Health and Safety Act, it states clearly that it is the duty of the employer to provide personal protective equipment to workers who may be exposed to a hazard of some kind. And perhaps the motion could just be amended that the GTA assist in the obtaining of personal protective equipment and provide health protection information to all taxi drivers, because I think unless the taxi operators themselves are working directly for the GTAA, if they are self-employed or if they are working for a company, it would be the responsibility of that employer or to provide for their personal protective equipment. And we get a lot of questions here at the City of Brampton with respect to how this will work. Is it the city's responsibility or the government's responsibility to provide PPE to workers? It is, in fact, the employer's responsibility, and workers have a right to know this, and they should be well-versed on this legislation.
Sorry, may I jump in, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Yeah, so, yeah, no, that's a really valid point, Councillor Vicente. So I think for the clerk, if for the second line, second recommendation, it state that the GTA assist in the ATA in obtaining personal protective equipment and providing training and health protection information. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. That is far more accurate, I think, and consistent with the Employment Act or the Health and Safety Act.
Okay. No other speakers. The motion is on the floor. And thank you, Councillor Dillon, for raising a very important issue. I've certainly heard it a lot as well. It's unbelievable that at this stage in the pandemic, there's anyone who doesn't have personal protective equipment, especially when we've seen deaths happen to those in the front lines at the airport. So thank you for this advocacy. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Is that the last?
Yeah.
That's the last added item. So now it takes us to 20. Public question period. Are there any questions?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, a question has come in from Sylvia Menezes Roberts. It says, this month, Brampton remembers the 45th anniversary of a mass shooting at a school. And when discussing item 16.1, which was the motion on the gun ban and buyback program, council also brought up a motion last year regarding the root causes of gun violence. In 2005, Toronto experienced what was dubbed the Summer of the Gun. As a result of this, the government of Ontario created a task force whose report on the roots of youth violence came out in 2008. They noted that guns do not cause a 12-year-old to kill someone. It is a series of circumstances that lead to it, and detailed recommendations to address the roots of violence, the roots of youth violence. What has the City of Brampton done to address the roots of youth violence and review the report since its motion on the root causes of gun violence in 2019?
Okay, thank you, Sylvia, for the question. Certainly, this is something that we're always looking at in terms of upstream approaches to public safety, about investing in recreation, tackling poverty, homelessness. We know that poverty and inequality can be a breeding ground for crime and social problems. We have a chief of police who is a huge advocate of upstream policing. If you look at the work right we're doing right now, investing in mental health as a part of police responses, if you look at some of the community safety initiatives we're taking on, the investments in recreation, I think it speaks to the fact that the youth hub, you know, that Councillor Medeiros and Santos were advocating, all examples of trying to build a village. You know, it takes a village to raise a child, they say. Well, we're trying to build that community sense in Brampton, where no one gets left behind and there are opportunities for engagement for everyone. And so I think the question was really more of a comment, and I think you'd find around this council table, Sylvia, that there is broad concurrence with your comment that we need to increasingly do more on tackling those root causes of crime and criminality. And I see in the instant messaging box, Councillor Santos mentioned that the youth engagement strategy focuses on a movement on the youth hubs at Century Gardens and South Fletcher's, and it's also being supported at the region. The fact that we got that support at the region is helpful because it's funding associated with that. So this takes us now to items 21, bylaws. I have a motion moved by Councillor Willen, seconded by Councillor Pelleschi, to approve bylaw 77-2020 to 80-2020. Councillor Pelleschi has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And just with relation to bylaw 21.3 to prevent the application of part lot control to part of registered plan west side of McLaughlin Road and south of Mayfield Road. So I've had a discussion at the region with respect to the property south of Mayfield, west of McLaughlin, the potential issues for flooding, the growth that's happening on the north side of Mayfield, and the need for the region and the that growth is needed for the channel through this property to ensure that there isn't any flooding in Brampton because of it. With this motion, the way it's written, and if staff could correct me if I'm wrong, does it give us the right, and us meaning, you know, the City of Brampton, the region, and effectively the developer on the north side to do all the work and pay for it, does it give us the ability to go on to the land through the easement to do the work that is needed to ensure that the development on the north side happens and does not impact flooding and impact our side of the border?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, this is Alan Parsons here, and really responding to Councillor Plessy's question. Councillor, the lifting of the part lot control bylaw, what it inherently does is really allow for some new lines to be really drawn onto the property. So essentially new lot lines can be created once this part lot control is lifted. It doesn't inherently give the city an ability to have any additional rights over the property as far as entering and such, but it does accommodate the drawing of new lines onto the property for the purpose of creating easements. So with respect to, I guess, our trying to achieve some additional rights over those properties, there might be another means in which we. I'm not myself familiar, Councillor, at this point in time about some of these engineering issues relating to that site.
And I've never really come across too much of these types of discussions, unless we were talking about the purchase of property to expand regional roads. So this is really one of the first times this has come up. And so I'd like, if there's an opportunity to include in this bylaw to ensure that, and I think the reason why I'm asking for it to be included now is that right now we're, McLaughlin Road is completely shut down in between Wanless and Mayfield. So any work that needs to be done by the, and it's private sector work, so they can mobilize a lot quicker. I would like that work to happen sooner rather than later, so that we don't complete this road and then somebody else is going in and affecting the community on the south side of Mayfield with even more construction, because we all know we hate seeing that. So is that a possibility?
You, and through your gun, Mr. Mayor, you know what I would offer, Councillor, is that I wouldn't think that this bylaw to lift park lot control would inhibit our ability to really work with the applicants to try to, you know, make some additional arrangements to, you know, take care of some engineering issues in the area. Lifting of part lot control will accommodate their needs for creating easements. I think really at the same time it could accommodate, you know, our needs as well, as you know, we see that we might need to work with them towards some resolve there. What I would suggest is perhaps, you know, this bylaw can go forward as part lot control is lifted and they can take care of their matters through it. We can work alongside them and we can follow up with our legal staff and our engineering staff to see what particular pieces we might need to complete to really resolve the issue that you're bringing up.
So I guess my only issue then is then, you know, we have a bylaw that's before council for adoption here now, creating easements and new lot lines for a development on our side, but then we don't have the easement for the expansion and the potential flooding that could potentially happen. I think we're lucky so far this year where we haven't had a huge flooding of spring, but I'd like the opportunity for us to just to do this once rather than us coming back to revisit.
Mayor Brown and members of committee, if I could just pipe in, it's Richard.
Please do.
Could I suggest that perhaps we refer 21.3 back to staff and we can answer those questions?
I'm okay with that. Did I hear Peter say something? Okay.
Are there any additional questions? So we have the motion moved by Councillor Willens and Councillor Pelushi for the bylaws.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, just to clarify, I didn't hear the conversation between Councillor Pelushi and Commissioner Forward. Was the intent then to refer that bylaw back, that specific bylaw?
Mayor Brown and members of the committee, yes, that's correct, so that we can provide a fulsome response.
Thank you.
Okay, so adopt the bylaws except for 79. The motion is on the screen. Any objections? Motion carries. Takes us to item 23, confirming bylaw moved by Councillor Willens, seconded by Councillor Pelushi to approve the confirming bylaw to confirm the proceedings and decisions from this meeting. Are there any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries. That takes us to adjournment. I would note our next council meeting is scheduled for May 27th and June 10th. I have a motion moved by Councillor Bowman and seconded by Councillor Medeiros to adjourn today's special meeting. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Hearing none, the motion passes, and I'll remind members of council if they'd like to join us in the Teletown Hall tonight. It's at 6:30. Thank you, everyone, for their careful consideration, discussion, and debate at today's council meeting. Stay safe, and until our next meeting. Meeting is adjourned.